Welcome to Escape to the Country. Now, this beautiful Jacobean house behind me has several claims to fame, but perhaps chief amongst them, it was home to Britain's first ever croquet champion and founder of the All England Club. In fact, the rules of the game were created on its very lawns. But where have we come to for today's little knockabout? Well, join me in just a moment and I'll tell you.
Today, family ties are the driving force pushing a couple to take the plunge and leave the city behind in search of a new country life.
Oh! Oh, it's fabulous. Now, I'm just already getting really excited.
And our properties provoke some strong emotional reactions.
You've got the wow. Oh, it's lovely. Shed a
tear. Good.
Well, today we are in Oxfordshire, and this is Chastleton House, the home of croquet fanatic Walter Jones Whitmore. It was on this very lawn back in 1855 that Jones Whitmore created and then published the very first set of croquet rules, rules which are still very much in use today. Now, later on in the programme, I'll be back here exploring this fabulous Jacobean mansion and also learning a little more about the very unique family that lived here.
Situated in the southeast of England, landlocked Oxfordshire is bordered by six counties, including Gloucestershire, Wiltshire, and Berkshire. This scenic county encompasses the rolling Cotswold Hills, as well as the Chiltern Hills, and covers 1,000 square miles. Oxfordshire's architecture is as awe-inspiring as its natural beauty, with the world-famous university city of Oxford the shining star of the county. The 14th century New College is one of the most significant medieval buildings of its kind in Europe. The county is located almost entirely within the River Thames Basin. The river provides pleasure boaters with stunning vistas and also passes pretty villages such as Northmoor and Kingston Bagpews, both of which display a real mix of country charm. So for escapees looking for a rural paradise, yet still within reach of culture and history, Oxfordshire is the perfect place to enjoy a piece of it all.
Well, when it comes to the cost of housing, Oxfordshire has long been a hotspot. Here, the average price of a detached property is currently £446,000. That's a massive £160,000 above the national figure. Why? Well, the reason is simple. Its location means it offers great commuter links into London and the cities of the Midlands. And, of course, those beautiful Cotswold villages have long made it popular with tourists, second homers and locals alike. All the reasons, in fact, that have attracted today's buyers to want to move here.
Retired civil servant Jane and partner John, a bespoke tailor, live in a three-bedroom terrace in St Albans, Hertfordshire.
We've known one another for a good 8 years, is it now?
Seven.
Seven. See, that's a good start, isn't it? It's been so enjoyable, I've added a year on.
They first met when a mutual friend set them up.
I kind of felt really funny when I saw you. It was sort of love at first sight, I guess.
Yeah, and it was. It was really nice for both of us, because that's what happened. Hello.
They've lived together in Jane's Hertfordshire house for 5 years. They love their home, but with a large family, they feel it's the right time to head for pastures green. Jane has two daughters and a son from a previous relationship, and John has a son and a daughter.
I'd just like some more space. We've got two dogs, we'd like to be able to spread out and have a bit of space, a bigger garden and a view of something.
I particularly like the countryside, having grown up in Ireland. I feel it gives me a bit more freedom of open spaces.
When they move, John will still be working, so his job in West London and an expanding family are dictating their relocation.
Well, we're looking to move basically around the Oxford area. It'd still be handy for me for work, for travelling in, because I still have to commute for another 5 to 6 years.
My family is very important to me. I want to be nearer my daughter, who lives in the Cotswolds, and she's got a little boy and my first grandchild, and I just want to be nearer them. I won't be too far from my son either, he's in South East London. And if we had the space, they could come and stay, and I'm retired anyway, so I'll have more time to see everyone.
Jane's other daughter, Rachel, a textile designer, will also be joining them temporarily. And when they move, Jane and John want to make the most of their new surroundings, as well as a good slice of quality downtime.
We love walking, don't we?
Yeah,
we do a lot of walking, and walking with the dogs is one of the best things you can do, isn't it? It's good exercise and it's out in the fresh air. And
we do look at our life in a way as a bit of an adventure, or we like to think that way, that we're young enough to do things and enjoy things and not sort of think, oh, you know, like, we're getting on a bit, perhaps we should slow down and think about things. We're still young enough to be out there doing things and enjoying it.
I'm just looking forward to starting something new and exciting, and I don't want to wait any longer and live the dream. That's what I want to do.
The ideal Oxfordshire location would be somewhere not too far from Jane's daughter in Gloucestershire and within an hour and a half's commute from John's work in Notting Hill, West London. So we're concentrating our search to the west of the county. And before we get off the starting blocks, we're all meeting up to make sure I'm up to speed on the finer details of their property wish list.
Well, what a spot, eh?
It's lovely, isn't it?
Isn't it?
Gorgeous.
Now, John, you're a tailor in London. Look, I've spruced up for you today.
I know, and look at Peter.
Thank you.
If I'd have known, you show me up here, I tell you.
Finely cut, I'll have you know. Give us an idea of the sort of property, then, that you've been dreaming about, Jane.
Right, I'd like something with character, obviously. I like old houses. Farmhouse kitchen with room to eat in the kitchen. A utility room, maybe, for the dogs.
Yeah.
Three beds, a bit of space around. I just want to stretch my wings a bit.
Now, you mentioned your daughter in Stroud, Sean.
Yes.
And your other daughter, Rachel, is, for the time being, going to come with you. So we do need to find her some space in this property as well, don't we?
Yes, we do. We need a room for her, possibly a workroom or an office that she could use.
And what about a sense of community, John? Have you thought about position for this new property?
Well, we don't want to be isolated. We would like something on the edge of a village. Something like that would be ideal.
And what about the budget, then, for all of this? Because, you know, Oxfordshire famously is not the cheapest.
No. But we've got 500,000 maximum.
The property market here is incredibly buoyant. It's clear that you want something with character and that lovely sort of country feel, farmhouse kitchen you've described and so on. Would you consider, you know, a semi, for example?
Yes, I would consider a semi, yes. So I know that 500 might not go as far as we'd like.
Well, we're going to try and make it go as far as possible. Don't worry about it. But, yeah, I think that's fairly doable. You know, we do like a challenge. Let's go and spend some of your money.
Come on, then.
For their top budget of £500,000, Jane and John want a character property that has plenty of space. They'd like a country kitchen diner and a utility room for their two dogs. Upstairs, they're hoping for three bedrooms, and outside, they want a garden with enough room for the dogs to run around. Location-wise, somewhere on the edge of a village would be ideal. We've hand-picked a selection of wonderful properties for Jane and John to consider, and it will only be after they've viewed each one that the price will be revealed. Our final visit will be to our mystery house, which will deliver their requirements in bucket loads, but with one small catch. With location in mind, we're kicking off our search in the village of Kelmscott, close to the Oxfordshire-Gloucestershire border. The village is around a 1¾-hour commute from London and boasts many properties that are all built from attractive ochre-coloured Cotswold stone. The renowned 19th-century designer William Morris described this village as heaven on earth, and he founded a society to preserve ancient buildings like those found here. Amenities are a short drive away in the small town of Lechlade, which has a good selection of shops on offer. But back in the heart of rural Kelmscott is our first property.
Right then, here we are.
Very nice.
Very pretty.
Yeah, very nice.
What we've got for you here is a semi, formerly farm workers' cottages. This one has been completely renovated and doubled in size with an extension to the rear.
Okay.
What do you reckon, John?
I think it looks very nice. I love the layout, the gardens and everything else like that. And it looks like, from my point of view, we're not having to do much. It takes all the boxes.
There is nothing to do. I mean, there really is nothing to do. Come on, let's have a look.
The original part of this house was built over 100 years ago, but the extension is just 5 years old and has been beautifully finished. We're heading down the side of the property and straight into the kitchen diner.
Come in. So this is the new extension.
It's lovely, isn't it? Really beautiful. I love the cupboards.
It's got that lovely, crisp, new feel to
it. Yeah, it's lovely.
There's a big utility room through there.
Yes.
They've got dogs.
Yeah.
And obviously they appreciate having that kind of boot room as well for them. So far, so good?
Yes.
Yeah.
And it all drifts rather nicely into here, which is the main living room.
Oh, this is a lovely room.
Yes.
It is, isn't it?
Yeah, it's really light and I love the wood burner.
Yeah, lit today just for us.
I was hoping there would be one.
The nice thing about this, because they added the extension, they've been able to knock through what would have been two rooms here to create this great big family room. But one thing where a lot of older characterful properties struggle with is storage space in terms of bedrooms and that sort of thing. But I think this might work. Come and have a look.
Above us are three bedrooms. There's a double at the front of the house with its own shower room. Next to that is a single with space for a desk, and at the back there's another double.
This is what is currently used as the master bedroom by the owners at the moment.
Yeah.
You may think they should have gone for the ensuite down there, but they prefer the views over the fields.
Oh, that way. That's a lovely view, isn't it?
You've got the family bathroom right next door. I mean, you could actually push a door in that corridor and it would create effectively an ensuite, master suite for you.
It's beautifully finished. We love all the details on it, but I don't think there's quite enough room for us.
I think it's a little bit small, to be honest.
I think when we get to the price, it will rather set out the landscape that we are battling with here in terms of
space.
Oxfordshire's property market and what you get for your money. Yeah.
Okay.
Let's go outside and talk about the numbers.
Okay. The garden here sits mainly to the side of the house and is accessed from the kitchen. There's a well-maintained lawn bordered by trees and flower beds, as well as a garden shed, a greenhouse and a patio with wonderful views across the fields beyond. And there are also some unexpected feathered friends.
Listen to that.
Oh, chickens, John.
It's the sound of the country.
Sound of the country.
Sound of the country.
You said you wanted chickens.
I did. I'm not sure if I'm ready for them now, but I do want them.
And there we have our nicely extended former farm worker's cottage.
I sort of feel that Jules is leading us onto something here and he's going to say, and what about the price? And then we're going to be,
Right, go on then, John, make us an offer.
Well, I think it's bang on the money, Jules. I think it's about the 500,000.
Oh, are you? I'm going to go a bit less, I think.
Uh-huh.
475?
You're not far, mate. It's on at 495,000, so it is pretty much everything.
Bang on the
money.
I
can understand that, because it is a lovely house, the setting and everything you're saying.
I was just being a bit hopeful, I think.
Well, look, go and have a wander around. The house is yours. And I will come and find you a little bit later on.
Okay.
Thanks very much, Jules.
Take your time.
Yeah.
This extended semi-detached house has come in just under Jane and John's budget, leaving them with £5,000 to play with. It's got loads of character, a kitchen diner, and just the right number of bedrooms. Now, it may not be as roomy as they'd like, which is something that comes with the pricey territory they're searching in, but there's a pretty garden with views, and it's well located in the heart of a quiet village.
Now, first impression, I've got to be honest, I really like the look of the house. It's still got the elements which I really like of still having a bit of old, but inside, very modern and very new, done in this very sympathetic way.
It's gorgeous, and looking inside, it's absolutely stunningly done up. There's not a thing to do. It was lovely. I couldn't find fault with it. The only thing I would say, I'm just not sure that it's big enough. I've got quite a big house now, and I'm wondering if we can fit in.
We've got a lot to do. We've got more properties to see, so shall we?
Yes, let's go.
Lead on.
Oxfordshire's countryside is the perfect setting for a number of stately homes and grounds, including the striking Waterperry House and Gardens to the east of Oxford. Parts of the house date back to the 17th century when it was a private home. And it sits in an 83-acre oasis of vibrant flowers, manicured lawns, and shapely hedges. In the 1930s, the site was a school of horticulture for ladies, and when it closed in the 70s, the house and gardens that had been nurtured so carefully by the students were taken over by a charity. Today, Waterperry Gardens welcomes around 35,000 visitors a year, and Jane and John have come to meet horticultural manager Robert Jacobs to learn more about these resplendent gardens.
So what's the thinking behind the design layout of the gardens?
It's education. We're always trying to teach. You want to have colour all the time. So you have a lupin season early in the year, you have a delphinium season high summer, and then you finish the season with the Michaelmas daisies.
What's the best thing on show this time of year?
Well, we're high into the early autumn now at the moment, and the big thing is the fruit, the top fruit, so you'll see pears and lots of lovely apples.
As well as the 8 to 9 acres of ornamental gardens here, there are also 5 acres of orchards. But when it comes to the fruit trees, not everything is as it first seems.
So, here we are, a piece of horticultural magic. This is our family tree. We grow approximately 60 different varieties of apples. We managed to get 50 apples on one tree.
That's 50 different varieties growing on the family tree, which sounds pretty amazing. It was an epic experiment and achieved by grafting cuttings from various apple trees onto the one tree. And from the juicy array of fruit now hanging from the branches, it's clearly been a success.
Can you use any type of apple?
The apples that we eat and that we cook with are an apple called Malus domesticus. So long as it's Malus domesticus, originally from Kazakhstan, you can use it.
Which are the best eaters and cookers?
England's a place where we have tradition of having cookers. In France and on the continent, they tend to just cook whatever apples available to cook with. As far as eating, it's down to your taste and also the season, because it's really important. Apples come on in a season, so that's why you have your early, your mids and your lates. And the tastes are different. They all got their own characteristics in that time.
Surrounded by so much ripe fruit, Jane and John are going to get the chance to harvest some themselves. Apple crops are ready to pick between August and November.
We've got some picking bags here.
Okay.
Head through there, arm through these two holes. That's it, first time. When you're picking, pick with the palm of the hand and roll up. You don't want to crush the apple. So if you can fill the bag, I'll get the box ready.
Okay.
Right.
Good.
Ripening under the sun, coupled with low nighttime temperatures, helps the sugars to develop, which makes them sweet to eat and produces a rosy red glow on the skin. Each year, over 40,000 kilos of waterberry apples produce 25 to 30,000 bottles of apple juice, which is sold here on site and also in local shops and restaurants. Jane and John are going to have a go at transforming the fruit into delicious juice. But they're not using the industrial-sized press in the pressing room. Rather, they're using a hand press similar to the method used before mechanisation.
We're looking to produce something like that, if you can.
Oh, wow.
These are the apples that you picked earlier. John, I'll need you to turn the handle. If you could feed the apples in, Jane, and then once we've filled up enough, we're going to swing this over. This is the press. And from there on, you will be producing apple juice. Keep adding it in, I'm afraid. We've got a long way to go, Jane.
Oh, I'm doing it as fast as I can.
You can see why these days they're mechanical.
Yeah.
Instead, we have John.
You definitely get that real smell of apples, can't you?
Yeah.
I've got to be looking forward to this juice. Yeah. Juice is starting to come through. Is there anything else they will ever add into it?
We only add a bit of vitamin C, because as you'll see, it's starting to go brown already.
Yeah.
And that's it, just like when you cut into any apple or eat into any apple, it's oxidising.
Yeah.
So, as you're cooking, you add a little bit of lemon juice.
Yeah.
It clears it all up.
Actually, it does make you appreciate what you drink, doesn't it? When you think what goes into making a glass of apple juice.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. There we go. Yay!
The lid of the press is closed and secured. Then, as the handle is turned, the pulp is squeezed and the juice extracted.
Here it comes. Well, here we are. Looks like cappuccino, doesn't it?
Yeah, well, basically, that's the product. Just a bit of filtration and vitamin C to clear it up.
Well, I'm going to try it now. Cheers. That is absolutely lovely, really. John, you try some.
I'd love to. Thank you very much. Mmm, that is lovely, Rob. That is excellent. Well, thank you very much for all your knowledge and help there, and really enjoyed it.
You're both very welcome. I'm glad you enjoyed the day, and good luck with the house hunt.
Oh, thank you.
Our house search continues as we journey to the village of Chadlington in the Cotswolds area of outstanding natural beauty. This archetypal Cotswold village is renowned not least because the constituency address of Prime Minister David Cameron is nearby. locals are served by a handful of essential shops and a village pub. Just a few minutes' drive away is the town of Charlbury, where there's a wider selection of amenities and also a useful train station which would get John into London in under an hour and a half. Back in Chadlington, we find ourselves at our second property in the heart of the village.
Oh! Oh, it's fabulous.
Yes?
I'm really excited. It's really gorgeous.
Oh!
Church.
And a working church. There you are, there. There we are. That is a sound of the country, isn't it?
Yep.
No, I'm just already getting really excited.
Now, this one absolutely is packed full of character features. It's about 1750. It's been in the same family since 1920. It does need a bit of updating. And this is one you can really put your stamp on, I think, in terms of making it your home without feeling that it's all produced for you.
Exciting.
Yeah?
Yes.
Come on, let's have a look inside.
Great.
This end of terrace cottage is Grade 2 listed and is built of Cotswold stone. And its facade hides a rather special home within. To the right of the front door, off the hallway, is a cosy sitting room.
Now then, Jane.
Wow.
Bit of period charm for you.
Well, you've definitely done that for me. It's very, very nice.
What do you think, John?
I like it. I know Jane would, because this is everything that she loves about the house, the wood burner, the whole look of the place and everything else.
It does ramble a bit, this one. The kitchen area at the moment is here.
Yeah.
Oh, OK.
You've got a cellar down there. Quite a decent size, about the size of that room.
Right.
And there's a thought that it might have been a pub once upon a time.
OK.
Because it's the only property in this street with a cellar. There's a utility area through here, which goes out to a very traditional-looking scullery.
It's got lots of character, Jules, and that's what I think Jane's interest for both of us really wants.
I wanted the character and something a bit different.
I think it's got a lot of scope for you to turn it into something that you really want without taking anything away from what's already here. You'd have this space, reception area, but also we've got a separate living room for you next door.
All right.
Come and have a look at this. So we leave the sort of higgledy-piggledy bits behind and step into a little more elegance.
Oh, this is lovely as well, isn't it?
Very cosy.
It's gorgeous.
Yeah.
I think the house is like just so much character. It's fantastic. The beams, the fireplace, everything about it. It's quite special.
And the character continues on the first floor, where there's a beamed family bathroom that serves four double bedrooms. There's a spacious room with a feature fireplace. And up again on the floor above, there are two bedrooms in the eaves, each with its own charm. Then, back down on the first floor, is the master.
Oh, isn't it lovely, John?
Oh,
gorgeous.
Like boudoir, Jane.
Yes.
My kind of room.
I think this is certainly the one that oozes character to me.
Yes.
I really want to get you outside into the garden because there is one more little treat to show you out there.
Ooh.
And the garden itself is probably a lot bigger than you were expecting too. So follow me through here.
Okay. Outside, a patio leads to a neat lawn bordered by flower beds, hedges and trees.
Oh, this is
amazing.
Isn't that
lovely? Now, this studio...
I spotted it.
Yes. Keep that in your minds.
Oh, wow.
But the garden is long and thin and it comes up here. And you've got all of this as well.
Wow, this is fantastic. It's so beautiful.
And it goes up just beyond those tall conifers at the end. You've got the studio there, which I'm sure Rachel will really enjoy.
Yes.
So, it is price time.
It's that time
it's
again,
It's that
isn't
time,
it?
Jane. So,
right, well...
Give us your best guess.
I'm going to say 495.
495, yeah, John?
I'm going to go a bit lower on this one. I'm feeling a bit, you know, cooler about it, so I'll go 475.
Well, I'm afraid it's not 495, or indeed 475, but it is several fives, I'm afraid. It's 525.
OK.
Oh, is it? Mm.
But open to sensible offers.
OK.
In a certain way, I'm not surprised because the house is lovely and it's got so much garden, and where it is situated like that, it's just what, you know, sometimes what the value of the house is and what you would think it was worth to you.
Take as long as you want. Understand it, see if you can find a solution. And I will come and find you a little bit later.
Okay.
Thanks
very much.
Off
you go.
Okay.
This delightful period cottage may be on the market for £25,000 over Jane and John's budget, but the owners may be open to a sensible offer. The country kitchen is certainly full of quirky character, and there's also room for the dogs. The cottage comes with one more bedroom than they'd asked for, and outside provides a rather lovely garden with a studio that could be ideal for daughter Rachel.
Coming in, it's just a beautiful house. Lovely features, just what sort of thing I'm looking for. Lovely cosy feel. It's just the one thing is the kitchen. It's not really workable for us at the moment, but if we could do something, have an extension at the back, then I think it would be the perfect house.
We really love the garden. It's got so much going on there. It's almost like two gardens in one, because the first part you've got, which is a really lovely manicured garden, and then when you go past that, it's got this lovely open garden with a little gazebo there.
We're getting there, aren't we?
I think so. I've quite a good feeling about it.
You've just got to be able to afford it.
It's the money.
Yeah, I know, it's the money.
Always the money.
It's always the money. But this isn't the only property, of course, we are showing you this week. Mm. But it's worth thinking about and putting it on the list, maybe.
Definitely.
Right, come on.
It's the second day of our Oxfordshire adventure, searching out a characterful country house for Jane and John from St Albans in Hertfordshire. And with a top budget of £500,000 in their pockets, they're ready to wave goodbye to the city to be closer to loved ones. And we've got a knockout mystery house to come.
Mind your head, John.
Come over here, mate.
Nothing like a bit of slapstick.
And I'll be stepping back in time when I visit one of Britain's most impressive manor houses.
Oh, wow. This is incredible.
Well, with our house search now well underway, our task of trying to find Jane and John a home has been further complicated by the need to help them reassess their expectations as to just how far their budget can go here in one of the most expensive property markets in the country. But with one more property to come, our mystery house, can we strike that magic balance between aspiration and reality? Well, let's see.
For our last visit, we're nipping just over Oxfordshire's western border into Gloucestershire and closer to Jane's daughter, Sian. Our destination is the Cotswold village of Little Rissington. Pretty stone houses are a feature here, lining the narrow streets, and the village hall is the centre of the local community. Just 2 miles away is Boughton-on-the-Water, which is one of the most famous and quaint of Cotswold towns. Here, lots of shops and restaurants can be found, sitting either side of the River Windrush. A few minutes' drive away, back in the heart of Little Rissington, is our final offering.
Right then, there we are. The riddle is over. This is our mystery house. It is technically a semi, but what a semi.
It's fabulous. I don't know what to say.
Well, we have shown you, I think, some really good examples of Cotswold's property this week, but to me, we have saved the best till last. This is classic. Yeah. We think it's about 17th century, the oldest of the lot that we've been able to show you, and it's all brand new.
All right.
Let's see what you think.
Our mystery farmhouse couldn't be more appealing on the outside, with its facade of Cotswold stone, mullioned windows and roll-moulded stone steps. It was extended to the rear late last century and has been recently renovated on the inside. The property is currently vacant and just awaiting its new owners. We're heading straight into the largest reception room.
I'm very, very excited to see what you think of this.
You've got the wow. It's got the beams. They're not too low, are they?
No, but it's a lovely space,
isn't
it?
Oh, God, it's gorgeous.
Love the fireplace.
Giggling. Shed a tear.
Ah, good. It's got all those classic hallmarks of a beautiful Cotswold property.
I know, I can see.
It's got character in spades and just looks so, I don't know, just big and lovely. It's incredible.
This would have been like the main reception room. It clearly will fulfil that function as probably your main sort of living space. Mm. But we've got the addition of this other reception room or dining room or whatever you want it to be. Again, another really lovely space.
Oh, yes.
It's had a lot of thought put into it to give it that modern twist, to make it amenable to modern life. Not least, kitchen. Check this out.
Can't wait.
All crisp, all new.
Oh, it's lovely. I love the colour it's done.
Everything's integrated, fridge, washing machine, etc.
Oh, is it?
Downstairs loo here, the new boiler is in there.
I love this idea here. I think that really works there. You could imagine the table
there
with that little sort of little nook there.
It sounds like Jane and John's furniture's already moved into our mystery house, and there's also lots to capture their imagination upstairs. On the first floor, two bedrooms provide just as much period charm as downstairs. There's a double with a feature window seat and aspects to both front and rear. A smaller but equally well-finished room sits opposite a beautifully tiled family bathroom. But we're heading up to the second floor, where there's what can only be described as a master suite.
So here we are, right at the top of the building, in amongst the roof timbers. Come over here.
Mind your head, John.
Come over here, mate.
Nothing like a bit of slapstick. We love the finish on it. It really is,
it's
interesting,
lovely,
and the beams and everything.
It gives you the entire top floor, and you've got this en suite through here. This is very different. It's got this lovely ceramic floor, underfloor heating.
Oh, my goodness. Well, look at that.
There's a bath, eh?
Yeah.
Can you see yourself in there?
I definitely can.
The shower's lovely, kind of waterfall shower.
It's lovely. I love it.
Do you love it?
I do. I'm not going to be, yes, I love it. I do. There's certain things, because it's got that smallness about it to me. I feel like I'm going to be around about it. But the style and finish of it is
smallness in terms of the access up the stairs to get to this master bedroom, right. But the house is, as a whole, I think, we'd agree.
It's just unbelievable.
It's absolutely stunning.
A step forward in size and space.
Yeah, definitely.
There's no two ways about it. This house is stunning. But because the old farmhouse and outbuildings here were converted into five homes, it means the outside space that comes with our mystery house is rather compact, consisting of just a small courtyard.
It does, however, encompass two parking spaces there.
Okay.
That is the downside.
But you get all of that. Have a seat. Come on, let's give this one a bit of consideration.
It's a lovely house, beautiful.
And moved you, I think.
It did. I got it there. I mean, it isn't the garden I wanted, but I think you could overcome it, actually. Just looking at this hedge here, you could actually extend that, and that would actually make a big difference.
OK, well, look, let's finish it all off, shall we? Final guess of the week.
Shall I go first on this one?
Go on,
then,
John.
Here you go.
OK. I would say it's right at the top end of our budget, and I'm thinking hoping a 525.
I think I'll go 510.
You're hoping at 525. Here's hoping then. 495.
Wow. That's a shock.
A good one.
A good shock.
And has the space they want, with two reception rooms plus a spacious kitchen diner. There are enough bedrooms for their daughter and guests, and throughout the house everything has been finished to a really high standard. The only compromise that I can see is the lack of a meaningful garden for the dogs.
I just want to see what it's like if when we're lying in bed here. I know it's a bit crazy,
but let's
just
lie
down.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is a bit different, isn't it?
I think our bed would fit in the space.
Definitely, yeah. As we were lying here on the floor, I think it would.
Yeah. I'm a bit blown away with this house. It's stunning. When I saw it from the outside, I thought, this is going to be it, this is going to be it. And when I came in, I nearly cried, actually. It was so gorgeous, and it's just the sort of thing I was looking for.
When we came inside and the house opened up, it was so beautifully finished, we just, like, quite knocked out by it. And looking around the house was really interesting, that all the way they'd done all the features to it, the way the fireplace looked and all that, it was just incredible.
We're going to go away and seriously think what we could do with that back patio. But it's a lovely house.
You have challenged me this week, but I think we've got there.
I think we might have.
Possibly. But we've certainly given you lots to think about, so I think that's what you need to do, go and mull it all over. And then we'll see what happens next, shall we?
Yeah. Okay.
Off to you.
Okay.
As we've seen, the Oxfordshire landscape lends itself to fabulous architectural delights. And Chastleton House near Moreton-in-Marsh in the Cotswolds is one of the rarest. It was built at the beginning of the 17th century for Walter Jones, a wool merchant and one of the nouveau riche who was climbing the social ladder and wanted to show off his fortune through his home. Over 200 years later, it was one of his descendants, Walter Jones Whitmore, who made his name through his passion for croquet. The house is thought to be one of the finest examples of a complete Jacobean building still surviving in England. The family sold it in the 1990s, and it was then gifted to the National Trust and the nation. I've come to meet Conservation Assistant Julie Davis to learn more. We're heading straight to the Great Hall, where an 18-foot table has been standing since it was built in situ 400 years ago.
Oh, wow. This is wonderful.
Amazing space, isn't it?
I mean, it's been described as a 17th century time capsule, but when you get inside it, you absolutely get that, don't you?
Oh, definitely, yes.
And dare I say it, I can't help but notice all the dust and the slightly shabby feel. Is that something I'm allowed to mention?
Yes, it's a Chesselton trademark.
It certainly has that sense that the family literally just got up and left almost yesterday.
Well, it was quite recently when the family left. It was only 1991 when the last lady of the house left.
And do you think the scale of the property had just overwhelmed her at that point?
Oh, yes. I mean, the upkeep on a place like this, as you can imagine, is enormous. The roof space alone, the roof keeping that watertight, etc.
But in a way, I suppose that tells part of the story as to how it survived as this wonderful Jacobean example.
Oh, yes. The family didn't have the funds to sort of update it and put your Georgian facade on the front and make it look more modern. They never had those funds, so it remains a time capsule, as you say.
So do you think they were slightly eccentric to set about building this at the time?
Well, the idea was that they would enter the gentry and become part of the aristocracy and live that life. And, of course, to do that, you need a large house and lots of land.
And you're buying, I suppose, a sense of pedigree, aren't you, in terms of the way you furnish it, the way you decorate it and the way you design it?
That's right, yes.
The house was in the same family for almost four centuries. And, fortuitously, it was their make-do-and-mend philosophy which has meant Chesselton has remained preserved in time. When it acquired the property and all that comes with it, the National Trust decided to continue this philosophy and has employed a keep-as-found approach. And nowhere is it more evident than below stairs, which had lain untouched for over half a century.
So we're heading down into the kitchen. Ooh.
Yes, the temperature drops considerably when you get down here.
Doesn't it? Oh, look at that, all the bells. I mean, this would have been the kind of operations room, I suppose, for a house like this, wouldn't
it? Oh, yes, it would have been a hive of activity in its day.
Look at that, nursery. Is that doctor's chamber?
Yes.
I had a doctor here. Master bedroom and best bedroom. I wonder what the difference was.
I've no idea.
I love that rather medieval-looking serving hatch as well.
Yes, that's amazing. It leads us through to the kitchen.
After you. Oh, wow. This is incredible. This is astonishing. Nothing's changed in here.
When the door was closed on this room in the early 1930s, it was all left in this condition, and that's how we found it.
The ceiling looks like it needs a little bit of work, but I imagine that's all part of the conservation ethic here.
There's a story behind the ceiling, that's why we've left it as it is. Family legend says that if you disturb the ceiling, ill will befall the family. So, hence, it was always left like this. So it's got 400 years of smoke and fat on there. And we've retained that because it tells the story of the house.
And that story continues upstairs in the Great Chamber.
Look at that. What would have happened in here?
This is where all the important visitors would have come and been entertained. Now, it seems odd it being on the first floor,
yeah.
But they would have brought them up here because it's such a grand room and it would have shown off their wealth.
An even more impressive room is up on the second floor, and it may look familiar. All 72 feet of it recently featured in the television adaptation of the novel Wolf Hall, telling the 16th century story of Thomas Cromwell's life.
Nearly there.
Wow.
Welcome to the Long Gallery.
This is amazing.
Yes, let's go for a stroll. This is what this was used for. In wet weather, they used to exercise in here. And when we did some work under the floorboards, we found some shuttlecocks, table tennis balls, etc. So they obviously played games in here as well.
No surprise it's sited at the top of the building because, you know, the landscape out there is absolutely wonderful. So whatever the weather's doing, I guess you feel connected to the outside, even though you're nice and dry.
Yes.
It's really, really fascinating, Julie. Thank you very much indeed. And I have to confess, I do rather like the fact you've left the dust and the cobwebs alone. Well done.
Thank you.
Well, now I'm going to dust myself down for the results of our search for John and Jane's very own Oxfordshire abode.
Well, it has been a challenging search this week, not least for Jane and for John, in more ways than one. But of course, has it been worthwhile? Well, let's go and catch up with them and find out. Well, Jane and John, how are we doing?
Yeah,
great,
fine.
Thanks.
Thank you.
It's been a really interesting week, and I don't just mean in terms of the properties we've been able to show you, but I'm particularly intrigued by your journey. It sounds like a bit of a cliche, but I think you have gone through a bit of a roller coaster in terms of how you've had to redefine what it is you're looking for. Is that fair?
Yes, I think it is. I think the properties that we've looked at have been really interesting, particularly the mystery house. We loved every part of the house. The only stumbling block was the garden, unfortunately. But it's given us a realisation of what we do want, what we're expecting for our budget, and what we'll need to get for it. So we might have to think of a broader area that we look in for that. It might mean me travelling a little more, but that's what's been really helpful. It's given us those sort of ideas now which we can move forward with.
How do you see your future property search going?
There's two houses as far as I can see. The mystery house was gorgeous and I did get the feeling for that. And the other house with the long garden, with the higgledy-piggledy kitchen, I loved that house and I would be prepared to think maybe of doing something at the back with the kitchen, but if only they were rolled into one.
It is frustrating. You know, there's no two ways about it. In anybody's book, your budget is not small. You know, £500,000 we'd all love to have to spend. But I'm afraid, you know, we are in a very, very pricey part of the world. But it's not the only part of the country which you could consider.
I think we'll find it, though.
Oh, I'm sure we will.
I think we will.
I'm sure you will.
But you've helped us so much to sort of make us realise what it is we want.
I am absolutely certain you will get there in the end.
Oh, I hope so. We've had such a good time anyway, trying.
Well, exactly. And let's face it, trying is half the battle.
Yeah.
Yes, it is.
Brilliant, guys. Well done. Best of luck.
Thanks very
Thank
much.
Thank you.
Well, the business of managing expectations is one that's common to many a house hunt, but to be honest, it is easier said than done. On the one hand, you want to harness the obvious passion that your buyers have for property and all their ambitions that go with it. But of course, on the other, you don't want to dent their enthusiasm in the face of whatever challenges you may come across. It is a tricky balance, but I think we've managed it this week. Now, of course, for Jane and John, their house hunt will continue. But I think one thing is for sure, they'll go about it with a great sense of fun. I'll see you next time. Well, I'm pleased to say that having expanded their search area, Jane and John have had an offer accepted on a thatched cottage in Wiltshire. We wish them all the best of luck. If you would like to escape to the country in Northern Ireland, Scotland, Wales or England and would like our help, then please apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.